Today I'm going to explain how physics started. It all started from a person called Galileo. Galileo, for the first time, tried to understand how the surroundings work. So it is the first step of physics that you understand how the nature works. And hence we define today that physics is the study of nature and how it works and so on. So there are a lot of branches of physics. Hence, we cannot define physics precisely. But this person called Galileo was one of the... He laid one of the foundations for the modern day physics. I'll just explain how. Galileo was the first person to go to the Leaning Tower of Pisa, and what he did was a simple experiment. You drop something and it comes down. Why does it come down? Well, it was irrelevant to him. But of course, he did think why this has to come down. But he had something great in his mind. So the thing was, he took two identical balls and dropped it from the Leaning Tower of Pisa. Of course, I'm not in Italy to redo it. I'm somewhere in a better place. So I'm just going to drop these two things from a similar height. And you can observe that two of these two fall at the same time. And this laid the foundations to something called as Galilean transformations. So the Galilean transformations are the basics of physics that we don't see today in the books that are written by one of the greatest of the authors. But of course, there are books that mention about these Galilean transformations, or it is also called as Galilean relativity. So what Galilean relativity does is it explains how the nature works in the simplest of the senses. So it defines displacement, it defines velocity, it defines the rate of change of velocity, because the term acceleration was not invented when Galileo was alive. Until Newton, we didn't know what acceleration was. Hence, he also discovered something that is quite simple. Say, I am on this object A and this is object B. So when you put two objects, if two objects are moving in the same direction, and if you are on object A observing object B, then the velocity of your object with respect to this object is something that is the difference between the velocity of the two objects itself. If the object is moving towards each other, then you simply add up the velocity to get the velocity with respect to the person or you, the observer, in object A. So that is the quite simple principle that Galilean transformations teach you, and this is very essential to understand Newtonian mechanics. Newton was a great fan of Galileo. And hence, when he was in Cambridge, and before he went to Cambridge, there was this plague that was spreading all across Europe, and hence all the schools were shut down. He was just sitting in his estate, and he was sitting under a tree, something which is similar to this, an apple tree. And you know, suddenly an apple falls on him and he questions why the things have to fall to the ground. And this simple question leads to some of the biggest theories that we have ever had throughout the time of human history. So that is called the universal law of gravity, because it is applicable to every single object in this solar system, in this universe, etc., etc. But however, I shall not forget to mention something else. Galileo also was able to derive something called the geocentric theory. That means the Earth-centered theory. Galileo observed through his telescope. He also observed many planets. Jupiter, many moons of Jupiter was discovered by Galileo. Saturn was discovered by Galileo. Hence, I'm somewhere on Earth. So if I look at this kite now, I think I'm standing at the center of nowhere. Right? The same feeling that Galileo would have got. We cannot blame him for that. And you cannot tell that he was wrong. But he was mesmerized by the beauty of this planet called Earth. So he said that the Earth was the center of the universe. wherein the universe was the solar system at that point of time. The solar system, the constellation that was discovered at that point of time. But later on, it was someone called as Nicole Copernicus, from somewhere in Italy, and he came up with a theory called the heliocentric theory through immense observations, and he said that the sun is at the center of the universe, not the earth. But other than that, the model of which Galileo had made was perfect, including with the satellites of many planets such as Jupiter. So later on, Newton came up with his law of gravity, which said that the force of gravity is directly proportional to the mass of the two objects that you have, the product of the two masses that you have in your, that you are trying to find out the gravitational force between, and the distance inversely proportional to the square of the distance between the two objects. So for example, here I have these two objects again, A and B. So this is A and this is B. So the force of gravity, there is gravity between these two forces. Since gravity is one of the weakest forces in the nature, these two rocks or objects don't come crashing towards each other. They don't. So if I want to find out the gravitational force between the two objects, what I have to do is I can get a value, or I can say a proportionality value that tells you not the exact magnitude, but a close to something what you can understand. So if I take the product of the masses of these two rocks and also divide it by the square of the distance between these two rocks, say this is like about 2 meters, my arm stretched out, so then I can find out the gravitational force between these two objects. But of course, the gravitational force between the Earth and these two rocks is greater than compared to those between these two rocks. So hence, these rocks are very happy to fall towards the Earth rather than towards each other. Okay? Because of one reason. Since we are finding out, we are calculating the mass, the product of the masses, the mass of the Earth is huge, and hence the Earth, the gravitational force between the Earth and the rock is huge. And of course, there is Earth attracts everything, including from a dust particle, but it's a weak force, so it is weaker, so it takes a lot of time to come down to the Earth. But eventually it worked. Hence, this was one of the greatest laws that Newton came up with. But there was also someone called Johannes Kepler. He just didn't see something around him or me or you. He just saw something out of this Earth. And he came up with three beautiful laws called as planetary laws, which is perfect even today. And it explains how the planets move around the sun. It explains the area covered by the sun. You can calculate the area. You can calculate everything you want in this solar system from Newton's law of gravity and Kepler's planetary motions. So this was something called as revolution, but it took a lot of time. A person called Tycho Brahe, a rich man Tycho, he owned an island near Copenhagen, and he actually went into his island, fitted the island with brass caps relevant to the position of the stars that he wanted to study, or the planets he wanted to study. And he got the data, and the data was given to Kepler, and Kepler was able to then analyze the data that was given by him, and he was able to come up with the planetary laws. Unless you do such hard work like Tycho Brahe, you can come up with the beautiful theories that stand out through the history of time, through the history of human civilization. If you don't do hard work, you can end up nowhere. And hence, this is the proof. And so with Galileo, he did so much of hard work, but at the end of the day, his death was too tragic. But yet, as I said, Galilean transformation teaches the basic fundamental rules of physics and the nature that is around me and you. So later on, we shall move on. Newton came up with all those laws, and yes, over. But when Newton announced this theory, there was a small hinge that was not explained. Well, Newton said, apple fell on my head, I'm not going to demonstrate the apple that fell on his head, because if this falls on my head, I may not be able to continue with my lecture. So Newton said, things fall off to the ground. But why do things fall off to the ground? Why gravity is an attractive force? Why not repulsive like an electromagnetic force? Why not repulsive? Why the hell it has to be attractive force? That was the question by the press that was made to the Newton at the Royal Society of England. Well, I don't know. That's what Newton said. And there might be a little bit of story that was behind the fact that apple fell on his head. Newton actually studied for 13 hours a day at Cambridge University. He was not someone who could think based on whether the apple fell on his head or not. He actually went to an occasion along with his wife to a ceremony, I think, and then where he was asked, you know, how you came up with this beautiful laws and so on. Then Newton said, actually I was sitting under a tree, you know, in my estate, and the apple fell on my head and I began thinking why it should. So it is not so. He was being humorous, and people who have sense of humor, they understand that, but not many do. So Newton was an intelligent man, he was a genius. And of course, the next genius had this man as his idol. So he was the idol to Albert Einstein. Newton was an idol to Albert Einstein. In fact, when Albert Einstein was able to think the reason why things fall towards the ground because of the gravitational attraction that we knew, he was actually scared to even publish, because he didn't want to go against his idol, the great James Isaac Newton. So Newton also came up with three beautiful laws called the laws of motion that stands out through the history of time again. It explains how the inertia works. Say, this thing, it was just sitting on the ground because of inertia, property called inertia. If I just throw it now, it will keep continuing to move on in some direction of the force applied. It is because of inertia. Unless there is an external force that acts in the opposite direction of the motion of the object, it stops. Okay? So this was the first law of Newton, or you can just say it is the law of inertia. So the second law says that, so say there is an object and you throw it with certain force, and the force is equal to the mass times the acceleration of the force. So the rate of change of velocity times the mass of the object gives you the force of the object. And it is expressed in terms of Newton based on the honor that was given to the great discovery by James Isaac Newton. Well, that's something great. But, you know, still the question why gravity is just an attractive force was not answered by Newton. Well, it's not his fault. So later on, a person called Albert Einstein was born in Germany. After all those drama that took place in his life, he was able to come up with something called as a special theory of relativity. It's a special theory of relativity. It was accidentally published in his school before being thrown out of the school. It explained how gravity works based on a fact that there exists something called as a space fabric. So if you can come along with me, now I can explain how the space fabric works with respect to the stream and the rocks. So here, you see the rocks, you see the water. So the rocks are like something called the planets or the celestial bodies in the universe. The water is something called the fourth dimension in this universe. The fourth dimension is nothing but, which is called as a space fabric. So if there is mass, the fabric of space gets depressed. There is a depression that is created in the fabric of space, and hence there is gravity. So the fabric of space is like something, a blanket that is pushing on all of us, and hence force There's always a push, it is not pull. So, hence, now, when I'm throwing this stone, I'm actually pushing this stone. Hence it is moving. It is not because the earth or the stone wants to move in that direction. It's not because so. And hence, it is not the earth that is attracting everything in this universe. It is this fabric of space, the fourth dimension of the universe, that is pushing everything down, including me and you, and every single atom on this earth is pushing everything down, and the atmosphere, and hence everything is falling towards the ground. So this is the basic explanation of gravity that was provided by Albert Einstein. If it were not to Maxwell to recognize his theory, because Maxwell was also working on the same, you know, on the same steps did the, you know, the Einstein did. So Max Planck was someone who recognized for the first time that Einstein also came up with this beautiful theory that has already been explained. It is the most famous scientific article published till history. There is no better published till today. So this was a simple way to explain the evolution of physics. So physics is something that is quite simple to understand if you're very close to nature. So if you're not close to nature, you cannot expect to understand physics. So physics is something that comes with observation. And then you do the mathematics. The language in which physics works is mathematics. If you don't know mathematics, you cannot understand physics. And then, if you want to come up with a theory, first you need to observe. The second, you need to do the mathematics, the computation that we call. And then, what you have to do is recreate the situation. That is called experimentation. Only then, you can come up with a beautiful theory as such as Galileo's or Newton's or Einstein's or any other great person. So today, I'll explain you how gravity evolved as a topic. And today, we understand that gravity is one of the weakest of the forces out of the four basic forces in the nature. So gravity is one of the weakest. But yet, it is the strongest because it is keeping me, you, everything on ground, and we are not flying out into this space. Thank you.